pracujeme s analytikmi, s mladými ľuďmi, s mladými aktivistami a uvidíte vlastne prierez týchto ľudí, s ktorými robíme, ale zároveň táto diskusia je aj akýmsi vzdaním úcty jednému nášmu kamarátovi, ktorý je takisto mladý ako vy, ako my a ktorý nedávno zomrel. To Vitalij Silický, známy analytik, ktorý niekoľkokrát prišiel na Slovensko a my veríme, že časom budeme môcť mať aj fellowship Vitalija Silického a toto jeho meno ostane vlastne stále žiť.
On sa stále drží pri moci, už je to 17 rokov, nie je to neuveriteľné, keď bol Mečiar 6 rokov, tak sme si mysleli, že to je nekonečná doba. Oni to už zažívajú 17 rokov, takže o tom, aké to je, čo sa tam teraz deje a prečo stále nevedia položiť jeho režim, sa budeme rozprávať s týmito tromi Bielorusmi. A vlastne ten posledný update, čo sa teraz deje v Bielorusku, je taký, že len za posledný mesiac zatkla bieloruská polícia vyše 1700 ľudí, v podstate, ktorí sa prehrešili len tým, že boli ticho na ulici alebo zatliskali, keď Lukašenko mal prejav. To sú také veľmi neformálne spôsoby demonstrovania, ktoré sa organizujú cez sociálne siete, hlavne cez Vkontakte, to je také obľúbené v ruskojazyčnom svete, ale cez Facebook, Twitter a tak ďalej. Lukašenko je z toho veľmi nervózny a potom podľa toho vyzerajú tak aj tie represie, tak napríklad v stredu, túto to bolo pred dvomi dňami, zatkli 400 ľudí, z toho 25 novinárov. Takže to tam ich z vás to určite viete, v decembri tam boli voľby, Lukašenko by znovu vyhral po štvrtý raz. V podstate od prvých volieb, ktoré vyhral v 24. to boli prvé a posledné, ktoré boli demokratické, odvtedy neboli žiadne. A to isté sa stalo teda v decembri, voľby vyhral, ľudia, pár tisícov vyšlo do ulic, brutálne vystýli a mnohých zatkli. Tvrdé, drsné to bolo aj v tom, že 7 prezidentských kandidátov opozičných zatkli. Z toho medzi tým už stihli odsúdiť troch na viacročné tresty do väzenia. Takže vlastne keď sa bavíme o Bielorusku, tak nie je to nejaká virtuálna diktatúra, nie je to len nejaká nálepka, že posledná diktatúra v Európe, lebo naozaj je to tam tvrdé a naozaj mladí ľudia, ktorí ako posledné týždne ukazovali, tak stačí ísť na ulicu v nesprávny moment, nemusíte povedať ani slovo, ani žiadny slov na rukách, na transparente ani nič vykrikovať a jednoducho vás zabasnú a zoberú. Takže o tom sa budeme rozprávať, plus o tom, že Bielorusko zažíva popri tom ekonomickú krízu, majú vyššie 30% infláciu, ceny potravín na iných produktov, tam sa tak
rozdúva. This so-called social network revolution, why he don't abolish internet? Why he don't block it?
He is actually trying. The funny story about Lukashenko and internet was the very beginning of internet story in Belarus. Lukashenko said, well, you know, close it down. And then somebody explained to him, it's not like the door which you shut, and then the authorities also need the internet. And he said that next time appearing on TV a few years ago, saying, well, everybody goes to internet, I will go there too. So he didn't, basically, he still doesn't understand the nature of it. But there are 3 million people using internet in Belarus today, even more out of 10 million population. So it's pretty well developed. It's high speed, it's accessible. But then look at this. In one of the most popular networks, Cyrillic networks, social networks, there are 2 million Belarusians. On Facebook, there are 600,000. On Twitter, over 60,000. And it's keep growing. What does it mean? That if Lukashenko shuts it down one day, instead of a few thousand people protesting on the streets, he will get a crowd of 2 million people who are really pissed off because they can't put their diaries and photos on Facebook. So I think that's the logic of this regime, that he's trying to balance between being harsh and trying not to piss off people even further. And again, he also needs that co-investment for other things, so it's really tricky, but there is a decree on regulation of internet already put in force, and we can expect any day any of our websites can be shut down. Well, we are trying to be smart about it, we are trying to have our servers outside this country, but it might get even worse than today.
Nastya, and these people who are on the streets, they are from opposition or doesn't it?
No, actually the most interesting thing that is happening now with this silent protest is that opposition does not show on public almost everyone. There is just one politician who showed up on public during such silent actions, and that is a confusing thing for the authorities, because this is the first time actually that such a self-organized actions take place, and there is no there isn't any single leader in it, and there is no political propaganda. It's the message is clear that the young people and people of all the ages, the citizens of Belarus, are just tired to live like this. And that's it. The message is clear, and the organization is very simple. You just come to the central square, you can clap, you can smile, and that is your protest. So in such way, Belarusians show that they protest, but this is a tricky kind of protest.
Pavel, I would like to ask you that KGB even now are using the same brutal methods as years ago. How do you compare it with the years before? Is it the level of repression is bigger, or is it still the same, or you feel some difference?
So after election 19th of December 2010, some analysts said that in Belarus cold civic war started, and it is true, because we have clearly split society, one part of the society, and it's a big amount of people, more than 50% are against Lukashenko and this system which exists in Belarus, and half still supports Lukashenko. Some of them really believe that it is the best way in which Belarus is developing now. And this split is clearly now much more clear than it was 1-2 years ago. While Lukashenko managed to support social stability, social order, and so-called social contract. But after 2011, when currency crisis began, Belarusians felt that this system is not working properly anymore, and something should be changed. But the problem is that as a leader of the country, Lukashenko doesn't want to change anything, because any changes in Belarus, political, economical changes, will bring to the huge changes in the political system, and Lukashenko will lose the power. And that is why the main goal, the main thing he thought about, it is how to keep power. And he will use any method to keep power, to stay in power. And in 2006, when it was previous presidential election, he proclaimed that he would fight with a machine gun for his power, and he will. It means that he is going to kill anyone who will try to change the political system. And last presidential election clearly shown that this system would be fight till end with the weapon, with the repression, with the arresting people.
I think that it's also important to understand that this economic crisis hit just recently, and it's summertime, and people immigrated to their summer houses, and they're planting potatoes there, and they're trying to survive on that. We expect the situation will get worse by the fall, when people will go back to their cities, they will use their money that they saved, they will have to send children to school. But I wouldn't insist that it's only economies that plays into it, because back in 2006, when people were protesting and standing in this tent city in minus 20 degrees, which was really freaking cold, people were there for freedom, not for economy, and we still had 20,000 people protesting. By 2010, the number grew up significantly, and I think it's now a combination of people wanting a little bit more of freedom, because in Belarus you have to get a permit for anything you want to do as an individual or as an enterprise, but also this crisis just helps to build up this momentum. And yes, you can feel in the stores how people are behaving differently. My mom's pension overnight was decreased by 50%, and if you don't have income in current in foreign currency, you are really in trouble. And I think that it just takes some time, and people will understand that the combination of things will actually work out.
Nastya, I want to ask you about your feelings. I think Lukashenko became president when you were 6 or...
Actually, I do not remember, but I remember that I went to the elections with my dad. This is the only one I remember.
So, isn't it depressive to have a Lukashenko for 17 years? How do you live with that?
Oh yeah, it's... I would say that it is always very good to mix things, to combine, to try different ways of everything. You should try and then choose. So it is just not more than, it's not enough. It's a stagnating for situation when you do not have any new brand, new strategy how to manage your country. It's not. It's a stagnation situation, and now with this all economic factors, yes, it is becoming worse.
Each of you travel a little bit. You can compare the situation in your country and in the West. What you feel is what you miss the most in your country?
So it's as for me as a citizen of Belarus, I think not only about me, but about the country. And I think what we lack it is a perspective for development, because we are in stagnation, like in old Soviet time. No perspective for future, especially no perspective for youth who wants to work for their country. That is why we have a leak of young people who go abroad, especially to Russia, to make business there, to study there, and they remain in Russia, in Moscow. Or many of the young people went to the Western country because they didn't feel that something could be changed in Belarus in the future. And during the last months, this feeling, one of my friends began stronger and stronger. And, many young businessmen think about how to make their business not in Belarus but abroad. And this is a great problem for Belarusians, but I think it's the situation, economical and political situation in Belarus, will change. Many of young people now will come back to their country.
I would be as pessimistic again, because I belong to quite a significant number of people, of activists, who had a chance to study abroad, and I did my master's in the States and came back to my country, because first I belong there, second it's really interesting to be there if you're trying to bring this change. I mean, if you look at this from the perspective that nothing can change, you can do nothing, well then you better stay outside. But if you feel you can contribute something, that's really interesting, because you can build the system. And we proved this with the magazine when they closed out the print version. We 1 month later came up as a multimedia magazine. But what I wanted to say, when I came to the States, I probably realized what I was lacking most in Belarus. When I came there, I was constantly asking people, can I do this? Can I do that? Can I sit here? Can I eat here? And people were looking at me like, why is she asking it all the time? And then somebody told me, well, you can do whatever you want. And if it's not allowed, somebody will hint to you that it's not allowed. In Belarus, it's really part of your nature that you are used to having a permission for everything. So I think that for me personally,